Society Radio presents a Chris from Brooklyn bonus content fun time. Here's your host, Chris from Brooklyn. So I'm talking to author and professor Dr. James Lindsay, who actually published one of it's a funny piece of satire, and it's a great hoax on peer review. It's the name of the paper is "The Penis Should Be Viewed as a Social Construct and Not as an Anatomical Device." Right? I guess I paraphrased that a bit, but it is.
Yeah, you paraphrased a little.
Yeah, sorry about that. It is just. It was great. I read the paper, and it is something, I'll say, like, it's very rare that you read something and you laugh. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of satire that is meant for that. But I read it in the context. It does exemplify Poe's law, right? Like, if I read it in the tone to get angry, I may have gotten angry at it. But because I knew – I was in on the joke because I read it on skeptic.com. You guys outed yourselves. For this hoax that you got peer reviewed and published in a scientific journal, and I just wanted, like, were you guys intentionally trying to be funny with it, like when you were writing it?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so I mean, what was the thought process behind the paper?
So the idea was that you've got this kind of academic field, the gender studies field, and if you're familiar at all with the literature that they publish, a lot of it seems a little bit bad, to put it mildly. It's often filled with all of this crazy jargon, this silly language that's very difficult to read. It seems to be nearly always morally biased in a way that insists that somehow maleness or men or something to do with men is at the root of many of our problems in society. And it just kind of follows the same pattern again and again. It often focuses on just ridiculous, almost trivial observations about the world, and then turns them into, by what it calls a process of problematizing, turns them into massive, blown out of proportion problems, and then writes these papers that are hardly more than glorified blog posts written up in very technical sounding jargon that, as we hope to demonstrate, is fairly easy to imitate. And so we thought, last year there was a paper that came out from a gender studies department that was studying glaciers, and they wanted to institute this new feminist glaciology, where you study glaciers in a feminist way and through some kind of feminist science. And it was widely advertised, widely reported as being suspected of being a hoax, but the authors have stood by it. One of the authors did a TEDx talk about the paper, the feminist glaciology paper. And so at this point, Peter and I, my collaborator, Peter Boghossian, and I sat down and said, this field might be ripe for a hoax in the style of Alan Sokol, who did a hoax of postmodern social commentary in the 1990s. So we thought we would write this, come up with some idea, and then write this absolutely ridiculous satire and see if we could get a journal in the field to pick it up. And that proved a little bit complicated because we ended up being offered a chance to transfer our paper to a small open access journal instead of one of the top journals in the field. And after a peer review process, that journal did accept the paper and published it with minimal corrections. And so we ended up getting the paper published on the other side of peer review.
Well, that's what I don't understand. Okay, so I understand that when you get something published, you know, that's what makes it newsworthy. That it shows that other people have glorified it. But you guys literally just – there's no study in it. Even in the writing that you did, it is just jargon. I mean, and that's what's funny. It's a very short paper, so somebody read this and decided, yeah, this is worth publication, and this is, I mean, essentially newsworthy.
So at least the copy editor at the place at the journal decided that it was worthy to pass on to peer review. therefore consistent with what the journal looks to publish. And then two expert readers who have expertise in the field read the paper, gave commentary. We made corrections based on that commentary and then recommended that the journal publish the paper. So people with expertise in the field seem to,
in the field of gender studies,
pass off on it. Yeah. So we assume. So it's a little complicated because the journal that picked it up is a social sciences journal in general. But on their list of expert readers, peer reviewers, they have at least five or six faculty members at different universities who would have the requisite expertise to have judged our paper. And one of those two left enough commentary to where it's clear that they understand what we did, because we just aimed to put a bunch of ridiculous stuff together kind of with linguistic super glue and see what would happen. Mm-hmm. So certainly there was some level of expertise in analyzing the paper. Now, certainly also the journal that published it had to have had some serious internal problems to have fallen for such a ridiculous paper. So it's difficult to say exactly what was going on, but it's pretty clear that something is going wrong with the peer review process, at least in some journals, and that's relevant to academia more broadly. And then something that has to do with gender studies is somehow relevant, because at least one of the readers did know something about gender studies and enough to call us out in the corrections a little bit.
So what were some of the corrections you guys got? I'm honestly curious.
Well, mostly the corrections we got two. She wanted more examples. And I assume it's a she, because all of the expert readers in the domain of gender studies listed on their website appear to be women.
Okay.
So I assume it's a she. But the one reviewer, I'll be more careful, that wanted more corrections, wanted us to include more examples to give a more thorough picture of the concept of what we called the conceptual penis, mm-hmm. and how it operates as a problematic social construct, referring to a bad part of masculine behavior. And then the second criticism is much more important in determining that the person that read the paper did know something about the field. And that is that we mentioned a tool of analysis, a feminist tool of analysis used very commonly in gender studies, known as post-structuralist discourse analysis. And I don't know what that is. I couldn't tell you.
Well, structuralism is just the idea that everything is a social construct, right? Race is a social construct. Gender is a social construct.
So, yeah.
I wouldn't know what post-structuralism is. I guess that's just the assumption that is just how it is.
Right. So there's post-structuralist discourse analysis is something. And we claimed in the abstract of the paper that we use it, but we apparently didn't, because we didn't know what it was. So we didn't use this tool. And then the reader that had given us the commentary had read the paper carefully enough to notice that we had not used the tool, and therefore pointed out, you mentioned in your abstract that you use, you know, post-structuralist discourse analysis, and yet it appears nowhere in the paper. And so that needs to be corrected. And so I thought at that moment that the whole thing would fail, but that we would be revealed as frauds. But in fact, I just went to Wikipedia and made up some sentences that sounded like what the introduction to their pro-structuralist discourse analysis entry was describing, and cited the quotes that are on Wikipedia, actually, from Foucault. And that was apparently good enough, because it made it look like there was post-structuralist discourse analysis in the paper. But at any rate, the reader had to know they had to know the technique, they had to know it well enough, and they had to have read our paper close enough to realize that we didn't use it, because we kind of thought we had.
Okay. So, all right. So they read it, they knew. Okay. So they read it, they knew that you didn't use this, but you cited it and there's no examples of it. So you just basically copy pasted from a Wikipedia article.
And well, no, that would be plagiarism. Okay. I went to the Wikipedia article and read things and then made up my best guess at what it said.
Okay. But you kind of intentionally tried to not know what they were, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah. I went out of my way to not know what I was doing on purpose as part of the hoax.
Now, I just got to ask you, was this mainly to call out gender studies, or was it also to call out, cause I know it's made like some, there's like a small murmuring in the news about like flaws in peer review. So was it more, I mean, was the motivation more the peer review thing, or was it more about the gender studies thing?
initially what started us was gender studies. But when we decided to go with this small journal, all of a sudden we had to attend to two problems at once. So we had to take into account the fact that the journal is one of these small open access journals, and see if that has any, see if that might be the problem. And of course, we can't parse between the two variables. All we can say, like we said in our skeptic piece, is that there's some problem, and its two component parts are gender studies and the quality of the journal. Now, there are reasons to believe that the journal is bad, obviously. There are also reasons to believe that the journal is not as bad as our critics have pointed out for the past couple of weeks, which is to say that they advertise a 61% rejection rate, so they don't accept every paper sent to them. That's a lot of people accused us of that.
They'll but because it's open source, I mean, I'd imagine, like, look, there's a there's a subreddit for, it's called Our Shitty Kickstarters, right? So for every good Kickstarter that actually has real technology, there's a bunch of people scamming. If it's open source, I'm sure there's just a bunch of people who, like, have an idea and are crazy that send them papers.
You see, that's the thing, is it's possible that this is a predatory journal in that way, although I don't have the evidence to conclude that. The thing is we went before we agreed to do it, and we petitioned the university library at Portland State University, where Peter Boghossian works, and we asked them if they had funds to pay the publication fee at the journal, which they had asked us to pay $625 to have the paper published. And Portland State got back to us pretty quickly and said, yeah, that journal is on our list of open access journals that's acceptable, and so we'll pay for it, which means that this journal is good enough to where some, many, maybe, university libraries are willing to pay the fee for the author. So it's not necessarily just, you know, crazy people trying to do their own thing or people trying to rip people off that's running this circumstance.
Well, no, I'm not saying necessarily that it is. I'm just saying if you're advertising a 61% rejection rate, but you're open source, you're going to get a certain amount of crackpots.
You'll probably get a lot of marginal papers. And clearly they reject 61% of them.
Yeah. And
hopefully they keep the 39% that's best.
Well, but I mean, but you guys got through, so maybe that doesn't happen all the time, but like you guys even had, I mean, the name of the research group, even it just sounds like something out of a dry movie. It's just Southeast Independent Social Research Group.
Oh yeah. That was my brainchild. I just made that up and it sounded silly and I went with it.
Yeah. It sounds like something out of like a Bill Plimpton cartoon. You know what I mean? Like it's just a very like rigid thing, but like don't, you would think that, so like a basic thing is like, I read the piece that they did on you on Motherboard, and that's why I reached out, and I found the skeptic piece from that, and that's why I reached out to you. But you'd think that somebody like just does the basic Google work if they're peer, you know what I mean? Like,
well, I think there are reasons why they would and why they wouldn't. So in this case, with the fact that the institution doesn't exist, that maybe should have gotten Googled. But with like our names being pseudonyms, there are unknown researchers that haven't published anything and don't have affiliations that might do good work. So you can't criticize that too much. And then, given that, I don't know. Maybe they should have Googled to see if the Southeast Independent Social Research Group exists or not. But at least they, you know, our fake names got a lot of hay made about them. But that doesn't really add to the conversation very much, I don't think. For example, my field is mathematics, and there was a famous mathematician named Ramanujan that was an Indian guy who got a hold of a math book by dumb luck, taught himself math, started doing it as a hobby with no education, no formal training whatsoever, and started figuring these things out and for whatever reason decided to send them off to the Royal Society of London and ended up becoming one of the most incredible and recognized mathematicians ever. But if they would have just said, well, you know, if they would have had Google back then and they would have just Googled this guy and be like, well, we've never heard of him. So he's a nobody, you know, you wouldn't want to exclude people just.
No, I understand that. Like, that's kind of part of the reason why these journals exist is that, I mean, so somebody like going for a doctorate who doesn't have anything published can get something published, right? Like, I get that. It just seems like I guess if you're just in the field of gender, it just seems like a nonsensical, because it, I mean, it is, you guys wrote a nonsensical paper on purpose, but like, I just don't understand how somebody could like then see like, you know, all the things and not look it up. You know what I mean? And obviously you can't speak for the journal, but it does seem, if I read that in seriousness, and I actually wanted to ask you that too, but if I read that in seriousness, I'd be like, what the fuck are these people talking about? You know what I mean? Like, but like, cause you added yourself, what, it was like 2 weeks after the publication, 3 weeks maybe?
No, just a few hours.
Oh, okay. There's just a discrepancy in the date on the actual paper. When it was accepted.
When it was received and when it was published.
Yeah, yeah.
We added ourselves the same day that they published it.
Okay. I'd be curious to see. I mean, I guess it's hard to like stay in on a joke, but it would be curious to see if you got some praise for the paper. You know what I mean? And I don't know, maybe you have gotten, like somebody found it otherwise and maybe you got some praise for it. It would be like a curious thing to see if people like really latched onto it as viable.
Well, it's kind of interesting. I don't know if that would have happened, even given how small the journal is. But there have been several people that have commented that the concept behind the paper isn't nonsense. There actually is a valid idea there. And then there are other papers we've seen in the field that are clearly easy to connect our idea to their idea and make this appearance like, oh, well, we really did come up with a topic in gender studies that has legitimacy, which of course is just part of why we wanted to do a hoax on gender studies in the first place. A field really shouldn't be that susceptible to hoaxes. And then on the other side, it shouldn't be to where there are so many papers that are largely indistinguishable. If you go look at a lot of papers in gender studies, I mean, for instance, go type in Google Scholar, type in stuff like.
I actually just typed in post-structuralism as relates to gender studies into Google Scholar. And there's like a dozen or so results.
Yeah, well, type in something like penis and see how gender studies and penis and see what comes up, or gender studies and phallus or something. Like, I mean, just unbelievable.
So, I mean, all right, so do people, all right, so I understand, like, this is what I'm trying to understand, like, because in academia, right, there seems to be a more and more pervasive thing with what's going on in, like, Evergreen College and that sort of thing. I had Michael Rechtenwall on recently. He's the NYU professor who got outed as the alt-right professor despite being a communist. Uh-huh. I had him on a while ago, but he's just saying, like, there is just, is there just money in this? I don't understand, like, it's because it seems like a massive circle jerk, like, the field of gender studies okay. And, like, and I'm just trying to understand what's the thought process behind it, and like who is acknowledging this is valid? Why are they acknowledging it as valid? Why are people dedicating their lives to it?
So I don't know to speak for them for sure, but I have a guess. If you read their literature, everything that they write is analyzed through one lens and one lens only, which is what they call a Marxian lens of power. It's all about societal power. It's that the women, in the case of gender studies, or if it goes into critical race studies, it has to do with various races, or you go get intersectionality, they start comparing these things on different levels. But the argument is that traditionally, and even today, certain people or groups of people, based on essential characteristics like gender or race, are excluded from power in society. And so the mission is to obtain power in society. It's to invert the power matrix. So like at Evergreen, though that college is a little bit of a special case, I think the goal is to, I mean, I don't know how deeply into Marxist roots you want to dig, and I'm not a great expert on it.
No, I mean, I'm curious about it, because it seems to be, because I'm a person who's taught myself, like anything I know, like I spent some time in community college, but like what I'm seeing coming out of there, and it's something that you want to trust, even if you've never been there, but it seems to be there's a pervasive culture of like, yeah, of Marxism, of leftist philosophy. And
that's sort of the idea. Yeah, there's this idea, ultimately, it all comes down in different ways, but the general idea is that there are two classes within society. There's the bourgeois people who control the power, and then there's the proletariat who don't. You can call them masters and subordinates, or masters and oppressed, or masters and slaves, or oppressors and oppressed. And the idea is that the oppressor class has all the power, and the oppressed classes don't have it, but they are the rightful inheritors of the power. They are, like in Marxism, it was that they were the producers. So they had a rightful economic claim upon what was being produced, whereas the bourgeoisie did not, because they were just managers or whatever else. And socialites. And well, in this case, you have this being done not in terms of economic class, but in terms of race or gender or other essential characteristics. So,
well, does that kind of come down to, because, all right, so this is the irony of the whole thing is like the places that this is coming from are the places, the discussions of privilege and all this stuff, which it seems to be like a semantic argument often. And it comes from the places of the most privilege. And it seems like the reason why they're avoiding talking about class is because once you control for class, a lot of their arguments go out the window.
Yeah, I think that's possibly true. Generally, though, the idea is that you have these people who have had power and that they believe still have power. So for gender studies, a lot of times the enemy is the patriarchy. That's mm-hmm. the masculine power holding over society that's keeping women down. And the goal is to overthrow that. That is why these demonstrations are so rooted in gaining power. It's not necessarily to gain money so much as far as I can tell, it's to gain political and moral authority in society. Well, the sad part is, as far as moral authority goes, is that they don't realize that they're completely undermining their moral authority, and they're doing so in such a severe way that whatever claim they have, so there are problems with race, there are problems with sexism and things like that, but by going the way that they're going about it, they're undermining the legitimate authority that they have and inviting like extremists on the other side to come in and just bulldoze them. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of the really sad part. And this is the curse of the righteous always. They think that they're doing God's work, so to speak. And so they are not about to be stopped, and they're not about to reconsider whether maybe the means that they're using are actually undercutting the goals that they have. Like, for instance, we've mentioned sex and sexism and racism, but the whole thing, like gender studies, is really, really concerned, as it probably ought to be, with questions about trans issues.
Mm-hmm.
And
so that was a big part of your paper, is it, you do mention like, well, obviously the penis shouldn't be associated with maleness because of trans women with penises. That was part of it.
Right. We use that as an introduction to say that the anatomical penis is not the best way to think about it. And of course, we weren't aiming to make fun of anybody. We weren't aiming to put anything down. We're just using a line of thinking that's prevalent in their documents. But the problem is that whatever the right answers are, whatever answers are going to help trans issues the most and trans people the most, whatever that information is, the more accurate that information is, the better. And the less accurate it is, the more you're going to have people backlashing against it. You want to, when you present an argument, leave it to where there's very little space to argue against it. And so if you're going to come in with really bad arguments, which are based in this critical theory, as opposed to, say, neurobiology, which uses much more rigorous methods, then you're going to leave yourself in a position where you're setting up, where it appears you're helping in the short term, but in the long term, you're setting it up to where the longer term battles are going to be lost, and it'll be much harder to recover because you've discredited yourself in the process.
Okay. So what you're saying is, all right, so their thinking is, or it seems to be, that the ends justify the means, but they don't realize that they're losing the hearts and minds of people on the way to the ends.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's hard to say much other than that one of the main reasons that Trump got elected, for instance, in November, was his backlash against all of this, you know, far left insanity.
Well, I'll tell you this right now. As a New Yorker, I notice, and like, I'm a guy who grew up in Brooklyn. I grew up middle class to poor, you know, and it just, I honestly feel like most of the people I know who grew up who voted for Trump hate hipsters more than they do Mexicans. And I try to like explain that to people, and they're just like, I don't get what you're saying. You know?
I get it. I live in the South. I hear it all over the place. The whole theme of they voted for Trump to stick it to liberals, meaning these far left people and the hipsters and so on, it's the most common theme. The only other thing that ranks possibly higher is the theme of the whole terrorism thing, which is directly related. And then the third issue, if there's one that's right up there in the top three, so two of the top three are that problem. And then the third one is they hate Obamacare. And so, okay, two out of the three biggest issues that got Trump elected come down to being sick of this insanity from the far left and being willing to take a risk. And a lot of these conservatives I'm friends with are very intelligent people, obviously, and they know they're taking a giant risk with Trump in the White House. And so they're taking this big risk on purpose, knowing that they don't know what's going to happen, knowing that it could be a catastrophe. And yet they feel like it's a necessary risk in order to do something to resist this creeping, they call it political correctness scourge.
It's almost beyond that. It's just this weird, overly sanitary, almost Victorian feel. Like
it's going far. Yeah. Yeah. And so now bring it back around. So what's Trump doing for trans rights? What's Trump doing for gay rights? What's Trump doing for women? What's Trump's administration doing for any of the progressive causes that these people are fighting so hard for? Mm-hmm. And they're fighting in a way that's pissing so many other people off, not because they're right, like they like to pretend, oh, if people are mad, I must be right. Well, sometimes it's true because you've told them an uncomfortable truth or an inconvenient truth, as Al Gore called it. Sometimes it's not what it is. Sometimes you're just off the rails. As they say, and you know, if people who work in customer service will understand, it's like they say the customer is always right, but that's not true. Sometimes a customer just needs medication.
Yeah, that's definitely a true thing. So you're starting to see, you guys, like I said, Mike Rechtenwald is a guy. You're starting to see Jordan Peterson is a guy who's like talking out against this stuff, because this stems, I mean, it seems to stem from the universities, and it seems like now there's like an uprising behind this quote unquote uprising, like this fight back against power, even though it's coming from, they say they're fighting against power, but it's coming from these essentially centers of intellectual power. And like, there seems to be like, with what you guys did and like with what Jordan Peterson is doing in Canada and like lots of other guys are doing this, how much do you see like a kind of a pushback on this on the level of, like, where you are, like, so you're in the academic circles, like how many people on campuses are annoyed by it, like how many people are with it, and do the mathematics guys like just steer clear of the humanities people at this point? You know what I mean?
I mean, we make friends with whoever, but we don't, our departments don't really mix. Largely, I think there seems to be the beginnings of a turning of the tide at this point. What's been going on for decades, probably back to the 60s, but certainly especially from the 90s till now, is that these departments have never been told that they're going too far. They've never been held to the same standards, or never being told no. And the reason is, of course, you have well-meaning people working. As far as I can tell, the reason is you have well-meaning people working in the university. They want to do the right thing. They're generally thoughtful, open-minded, generally what you might call liberal-minded people. And so people come in and say, blah, 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 sexism, blah, blah, blah. Well, they don't want to be sexist, so okay. And blah, 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 racism. And they don't want to be racist, so okay. And then it's gone from where people were making what were seemingly reasonable requests and being given a green light every time, to now they've got decades of scholarship built up from these departments that gives them academic credentials. And they're using those academic credentials to say, oh, look at all this scholarship we have backing up our point. And so now you have to give us more. And so now you have stuff like where if there's an event like at Evergreen, the students make demands, and these demands are always centered in the rhetoric coming from these departments. And then the faculty members from those departments back sign and circulate those memos of demands. And then the faculty or the administration cave to those demands again and again and again and again. And it's always coming from the same place. And it's always the same pattern. They just have to have some event that sets off as a flashpoint. And once they have, and I'm not saying that they're sitting there waiting for such things. I think they're just trained to take advantage when they pop up. Then they make these demands, and the demands happen. And once the demands happen, the faculty nearly always just goes along with it. And so that means, as you're saying, yeah, they're gaining institutional power. And it's sort of ironic because they say that they're trying to fight against abuse of what they call hegemonic power. But in reality, they at the university level, they mostly already have that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
everybody's rightfully, I mean, nobody wants to be a racist or a sexist or whatever in the academy, but people are terrified because it's the end of your career to be branded a racist or a sexist or anything of that kind and have that label stick. And so this has been given, you know, this gives these departments a powerful weapon, and they've kind of redefined the way we talk about racism and sexism to turn it into this systemic stuff so that they can use that weapon almost unstoppably. So until administrators start saying, no, we're not giving into these demands. Mm-hmm. You need to stop this. And maybe even going as far as expelling students who engage in these demonstrations and things like that, rather than like at Yale where they gave them like awards for courage. I mean, come on.
Yeah. I mean, it's to the point where, I mean, the big one a few years ago was the girl with the mattress. And I don't know what happened there, but like it was determined.
It's not pretty.
Yeah. It was determined that she didn't like it whatever. The university determined that what her account of events didn't seem likely. And there were still pieces written about her in the newspaper. She brought a mattress on stage at graduation. She was like lauded as like a hero. And it's just like from the evidence, it seems like she just ruined someone's life.
I don't know
if that's true or not, but it just like it seems to be, you know what I mean? And I don't want to say, you know, you don't want to blame a victim, and that's not what I'm here to like do. That's not what I'm trying to do, but it does seem like these people, like it's just like, I'm just going to call you the semantic argument that racism is prejudice plus power shuts down conversations so fast when you just like call out a hypocrisy or a bigotry. And but if you use the word racist by its dictionary definition, people say, well, that's not racism. This is racism. It's like, well, now we're not talking about the issue anymore.
See, that's what I'm talking about. They redefine the term so that it has to be played according to the rules that they've set, so that they have the hand stacked. Or the deck stacked to their hand so that they're going to win. And
it's also kind of like, as somebody like, so you're in that, you're a mathematics professor. Nobody can look you in the face and say, you're not as smart as me, right? Like, but.
Well, let me be clear about that. I was a mathematics professor. I'm not any longer. I haven't done that in a few years.
Okay, you're a philosophy professor as of right now. Correct?
I'm not a professor at the moment, actually. I am, we'll call it a rogue academic. I work on my own.
Okay. Well, that's another thing that we're starting to see more and more pop up, like people doing that sort of thing, going online, publishing things, just writing books, and it's actually interesting. I'll get to a point I was going to make in a second. But it is what I'm saying is like, so by changing the argument, you're not solving the and I don't understand why they're okay just changing the argument instead of solving the problem. And it seems to be like there's just, at the end of the day, there's just money in it, right? Like there is, right? Like there's clout and money in publishing these nonsensical papers, right?
I know that there's clout. I don't know how much money there is, but I know that there's clout, and I know that there's power, and I know that so a lot of my research since I've left the university, a lot of my research has been into the psychology that lies underneath religion, which applies to psychology that lies underneath cults. And a lot of times when you feel like you're on a mission from God, then whether there's money in it or not, and when I say God here, I mean when you feel like you're doing the right thing that's going to make society better, a lot of times money isn't necessarily what's pushing you. And in this case, I think it's that they are literally trying to create some kind of a utopia, which is almost always the scariest thing somebody can get involved in.
Well, it never, I mean, we all remember the 80s, right? Like it doesn't end well, you know,
it doesn't end well.
It ends in oligarchy eventually. I mean, that seems to be the point. But so here's one thing I did want to talk about. As long as I've got you here, it just came to mind. As you describe yourself as a rogue academic, and I just wonder. So during the last election, and, you know, I wasn't – a lot of people were saying that education should be free in this country. And I was just, like, looking at them, and I was just like, you guys all went to college, and you didn't know how the primary system worked. Why should the taxpayers fund that? You know what I mean? So, like, is what you're doing, is what people are doing, like, whatever, Khan Academy, all this stuff that's online, in a world where literally more people have access to the internet than indoor plumbing – do we need to rethink what we consider an educated person?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. That's really outside of my my scope. Certainly there are benefits to traditional education, which is the corrective mechanism that's there. So if you have an expert professor, that professor will not just give you meaningful assignments, but will correct the way that you're thinking when you've misinterpreted things to, you know, by utilizing their expertise. Then there's a big problem with people assuming more expertise than they have, the so-called Dunning-Kruger effect.
Okay.
So it's hard to say. I mean, there's this line between where it is legitimately the educational service and what all goes into that, and a line between where there's credentialing and then what qualifies somebody as each of these things. But that's really beyond my scope to be able to say.
Well, yeah,
there are certainly elements, though. Autodidacts have always been a thing, and certainly autodidactic people can be very well educated and even contributing at the research frontier if it comes to it. So there is some discussion to be had about that, I'm sure.
Well, all right. So like go to your first point, when you're saying the corrective nature of things, but like, all right. So a lot of the stuff we were kind of criticizing with the gender theory, the race study stuff, like that I feel is pervasive in day-to-day culture, in just conversationally, which, you know, and it's, I don't want to use the word nonsense, but it kind of comes up nonsensical. But you have these people because they've been taught in a school this, because they went to whatever Wesleyan or something like that. They've been taught. I literally sat in a room with a bunch of girls who biracial girls, my buddy's wife, and they're sitting there going, race is a social construct. And I was like, you realize you guys look different than me, right? Like, this is not a social, it's not purely a social construct. There's something else here. There's geographical things. It's not purely a social construct. And so I think that's what's fun. Like I understand what you're saying with the corrective nature of education, but at the same time, if you're correcting things the wrong way, isn't that a problem?
Yeah. So that's why we wanted to target gender studies, because most of your fields, so like biology, for example, nobody has a problem with the way biology proceeds and questions and its own.
Well, any science. Hard sciences, any of the hard sciences. Yeah. Everybody, there's just,
right.
This is just how the math works.
And then even so, the softer sciences and even the humanities in particular are more susceptible to falling into fashionable traps, to where this kind of line of thinking is considered right, but really all it is an orthodoxy. And of course, that needs to be corrected against. But the way that the correction operates is what's not happening in gender studies. There has to be pushback, whether that comes from other fields or whether that comes from internally. But there can't be this kind of what I've referred to as academic inbreeding. Other people call it ideological blinkering, to where when people, so with like gender studies, philosophers and scientists have criticized the things that they're doing, and then they just ignore those criticisms and carry on. So our point more broadly with this hoax, like if you really want to get to the bottom of it, isn't just like, hey, let's pull a prank on some people. It's if there is a academic field in academia, in the university, that has departments in the university, that does things in the university, if there's an academic field that is susceptible or that is engaging in this not properly academic behavior, which means they're not using good epistemologies to get to the bottom, if you want to talk philosophically, to get to the bottom of their questions, then those particular fields need to be identified and they need to be held to a higher standard of rigor. Otherwise, it drags the whole academy down. And so that's why we wanted to target gender studies. We maintain a deep suspicion that what they're doing is actually kind of making a bubble, an echo chamber bubble for themselves, and then repeating the same things and then teaching it to the same things or the same people, and then just continuing this. It's more of an indoctrination in that sense than it is an education. Mm-hmm. And that's not what should be happening at the university. So something has to draw attention to it to get it out of the university if that's what's going on. And therefore, that's why we wanted to bring a hoax up and say, hey, look, this is what's going on. There's ideological blinkering there. When people refuse to accept criticism from outside fields and say, oh, well, we have to adjust what we're saying because science, a harder science said that we're wrong in our theory. If you're unwilling to adjust to that, and then the evidence keeps mounting against you, but you still carry on, you're no longer engaged in the academic project. You're now engaged in an indoctrination project. And I'm not going to say there's no place for that, you know, freedom of speech, blah, 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 you know, have your own church, have your own platform, have your own club, whatever you want, get the hell out of the university.
Mm-hmm.
Cause that's not education. I mean, the Christians, I'm not going to like harp on religion or whatever, but pay attention that, you know, Liberty University, which is hardcore evangelical Christian, calls what it's doing education.
Okay. So it, all right. So you agree. I kind of have the same thought. It is dogmatic at a point, right? Like, so this is just a new religion.
Total orthodoxy of belief. And it, like I said, it doesn't matter what your beliefs are. What it matters is, are you willing to adjust your beliefs to contradictory evidence? And there's hard evidence in the gender studies, and plus an overwhelming justifiable suspicion just by looking at it, that they are not doing that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what's happening, if they're not adjusting to contradictory information, but rather they're making up reasons why they're still right, which is what theologians did in the 1960s and 70s when they got crapped on. They made up reasons why they're still right anyway.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, you have now left the academy. You have now, or the vision of the academy, and you've become activists posing as academics instead. And I'm sorry, there's just no place in the university for that. Go do it on your own times. As Stanley Fish wrote in the 1990s, early 2000s, something, maybe it's before that. Stanley Fish wrote at one point, save the world on your own time, not at the university.
Okay. That's a great quote. So your paper, like, how does this snowball the way how can your message or any of these, like the similar message of this flaw in academia, how can that message snowball to as a way of reform? Like, I hate to suggest government intervention, but
right. Yeah. I mean, this is a matter of, it's not the government that needs to intervene. It is the university administrators need to find a way to feel.
But how do you have that revolution of ideas? You know what I mean? Because it seems so entrenched, and you never think something will change if it's entrenched like that. But it you start to see the murmurings of it, like with what you guys are doing. Like I picked up on almost immediately, but it's like how do you get to the point where you're not just preaching to the choir, where you can start changing some of these minds that are kind of brainwashed?
It's just a matter of continuing to draw attention to it at the moment until the point where universities, and that has to be the focus, universities have to take on the departments themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Gender studies, enough pressure could be done on gender studies departments or gender scholarship more broadly, like including gender sociology, to start calling out bad scholarship and clean up their own fields before they get their reputations dragged into it. Or university administrators are going to have to start realizing that it's in their best interest and it's in line with the vision of what a university is, in order to do the mission of their school, to start saying, you know what, this is going too far. This is no longer academic pursuit. It's now activism posing as academics, and that's not what our university is about. So we're drawing a line. And if they pitch a fit, let them pitch a fit.
And let everybody, they can go save the world on their own time.
Exactly. And so I think that's ultimately what's going to happen is the message has to be continually brought to clarity that the universities, the administrators at the universities, it is in their best interests. In the long run, their institutions will fare better. They will have more students. They will be able to attract a wider student base. Because the way it is right now, there's a gigantic movement in the conservative half of the country to not want to send your kids to college. So you're going to cut out a gigantic proportion of your potential student base. And so the universities are going to have to do something about this. Now, conservatives aren't saying, oh, you have to teach this other nonsense instead. But they're saying, quite reasonably, get the nonsense out of the university. Teach history. Teach mathematics. Teach physics. Teach political science. Teach gender sociology if you want to. But do it in accordance with good, rigorous methods that adhere to science and good philosophy and are not merely activists trying to push an agenda and not willing to hear anything different.
What they're preaching as fact is a philosophy. It's philosophy, but
it's a bad philosophy.
Sure, it can be a bad philosophy, but it is a philosophy, and they're preaching it as this rigorous fact. And I think that's where the problem lies, right? This is fine to teach. That's what you were kind of saying, right? Like it's fine to teach. Just show your methodology, and I think you should kind of let people know that this is one way to look at the world, not the way to look at the world.
That's kind of what the hoax is, right? People have accused us. They're like, oh, it's not okay. You shouldn't hoax a field because if you aren't experts in it, then, you know, you're not really qualified and it's not really ethical to pretend you know something you don't. I mean, that's bull crap, right? They should be able to detect, the experts in the field should be able to detect that it's not expertise. If I tried to write a bogus biology paper, I mean, maybe I could do it, but it would be extremely difficult because the standards of rigor are very high.
Well, yeah, because there's basic information on how things work.
And the methodologies are very clear, and it's very easy to tell whether or not...
It's observable. That's the difference, right?
It is. But even like in a more wishy-washy, or sorry, that's not a fair word, even in a more, in a softer field like political science, where there's a lot more flex and philosophy worked into it, there are still rigorous methodologies that allow experts to do a better job of determining when something's bogus and when it's not. And that ultimately has to be the point at which the rubber meets the road and some decisions are made about whether or not these departments are fulfilling an academic mission or trying to do something different.
Okay. All right. I think I've got, I actually, I'm really thankful. We went over the amount of time I said, and I just want to thank you again for coming on. The Penis as a Social Construct is the name of the paper. It's funny as hell to anyone listening. Should go read it. You and your co-author have a book out, Everybody is Wrong About God. At God Doesn't on Twitter is your Twitter handle, and I think everybody should follow it. And honestly, like I said, thanks again for just your time. It was an enlightening conversation, and that paper did honestly make me laugh. And
oh yeah, it makes me laugh every time I look at it.
It is something to say when, like, so many authors are written as like, I picked up a David Sedaris book recently, and everybody's like, this is laugh out loud funny. I'm like, this isn't funny. But when I read your paper, I laughed to myself in my house. And that's like a hard thing to do.
I spit cereal through my nose a couple of times when I was reading it one day.
Oh, you rereading it, editing your own. Yeah, it's funny. It's legitimately funny. If I read the whole thing, I actually might just cut an intro where I read the entire paper.
It's really fun to listen to. Don't cut it out if you laugh. Just plow through. They're great to listen to.
Actually, yeah, you know what? I am going to do that. I'm going to cut an outro. Once we get off the phone, I'm going to read. I'll read that for people so they don't even have to go look for it, because I know that people listening to things in their earbuds at work are lazy and will not go find it.
All right, great.
All right, thanks a lot, James.
All right, thank you.
All right, appreciate it. Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed the interview. I thought it was a really interesting subject. I think the subject of peer review is going to come up more and more. It's going to come under more scrutiny, especially things like gender studies. I love seeing guys like James and like Jordan Peterson and all these guys like kind of fighting back against some of this pervasive stuff in academia. I'm not going to read the entire study, as I said during the interview, but I will just read you guys the introduction. I'll read you the abstract. So anatomical penises may exist, but as a preoperative transgendered woman also have anatomical penis, the penis vis-a-vis maleness is an incoherent construct. We argue that the conceptual penis is better understood not as an anatomical organ, but as a social construct isomorphic to the performative toxic masculinity. Through detailed post-structuralist discursive criticism and the example of climate change, this paper will challenge the prevailing and damaging social trope that penises are best understood as the male sexual organ and reassign it a more fitting role as a type of masculine performance. Now, hearing that, I don't understand how anybody... I'll post this on Reddit, so you can go find that reddit.com/r/highsocietyradio. You read that and you say, how could anybody take this remotely seriously? Even given the fact that, peer review journals are sometimes there for people that aren't necessarily in that world and they've never been published before. It's so stupid. Using a penis as an example for climate change? Whatever. I just wanted to read you guys that. I'll post the whole thing. I'll post it on Twitter. You guys will have access to it. By the time this is up, on iTunes, I will have posted it, and I'll post it in the forums on Gas Digital before the show is released on iTunes. All right, guys, thanks a lot. Have a good one.
Yes. Pay full attention. This is for gangsters. This
gentlemen. There's two kind of people out there. I happen to be the boss type. I'm a product of my environment. Blame the streets. I am what they made me. My pops came from Bed-Stuy, my mom came from Africa. I'm old nigga if you know what I mean. They hooked up in the 70s when liquor and weed was heavy and had me in Corona, Queens. By the time I was 7, my mom left my pop and we moved to the south side of Yonkers, New York. Then my mom remarried, had my little brother Gary. My sister a year later let me gather my thoughts. By the time I was 9, I was out of my mind. My step-pops didn't like me, beat me out of my mind. 10 and 11 the same, I never would change. He still had to hit me. Aggravated little niggas still wearing Skippies. Golf had Adidas and Pumas, I could've had a pair. But mommy said wait till Christmas, but I needed them sooner. If you heard I was broke dog, it wasn't a rumor. I said gangsters ride
with me.
Gentlemen, live your life,
live it up.
Cause gangsters die,
we all gon' die.
It's only a matter of time.
The clock ticking.
I said gangsters
ride
with me. Gentlemen, live your life,
live it up.
Cause gangsters die,
we all gon' die.
It's only a matter of time.
The clock ticking.
It was 1986 and I was 12 years old.
Yeah.
That's right around the time when crack came out. Yeah. It was the best thing that happened to me. I swore to God, cause I was getting everything that I was asking about. First we started off bagging up. Me and Garth, then shit start adding up. We getting smart. Now we on Broadway, copping our own base. Bring it home, put it in bottles, sit in Serato. Drink a OE and scramble like it wasn't tomorrow. I'm getting kicked out of junior high, thinking I'm grown. Garth bust with the yellow rabbit. And I had every color Delta V was getting it on. I was out robbing Mexicans, 6 in the morn. Mom said I had an F again, riffing I'm gone. Nigga get a little loot and he groan, souped in the dome. Fuck me up worse when I went to the group home.
I said gangsters
ride with me.
Gentlemen live your life,
live it up.
Cause gangsters die,
we all gon' die.
It's only a matter of time.
The clock ticking.
I said gangsters
ride
with me.
Gentlemen, live your life,
live it up.
Cause gangsters die,
we all gon' die.
It's only a matter of time.
The clock ticking.
I'm leaving out a lot of shit, nigga, it's too real. My alcoholic background, the wealth in motels. Abuse that I had to take, struggle that my moms went through. How the fuck I'm gon' bond with you? In the cases I got up to date, told you that I bust the 8. Got niggas I can't name out of state, cause they fuck with weight. Little brother gone, but I got a bigger angel. You fucking with a dirty game, don't let these niggas change you. The present's what you get, and the past is what make the man. The future, I can't tell you I ain't God or no Superman. No, it ain't an S on my chest, but it's a D on my block. Cause in life the deepest lesson is death. I'm determined and I'm disciplined and destined to rep. I'm a gangster and a gentleman, Pinero the best. When I pass I'm like gas, motherfuckers, cause I'ma leave a stink that you'll never forget.
I say gangsters
ride
with me.
Gentlemen live your life,
live it up.
Cause gangsters die,
we all gon' die.
It's only a matter of time.
The clock ticking.
I say gangsters
ride
with me. Gentlemen live your life,
live it up.
Cause gangsters die,
we all gon' die.
It's only a matter of time.
The clock ticking.